تلقى وأضاءني الدنيا طريقا مشرقا وهدى من الرحمن يهدينا به للصالحات وللمكارم والتقى هذا كتاب الله أعذب منهل أنعم به من مورد لمن استقى قد صانه رب العباد بحفظه وحماه حتى لا يضيع ويخلقا طوبى لمن حفظ الكتاب بصدره فبدا وضيئا كالنجوم تألقا وتمثل القرآن في أخلاقه وفعاله فيه الفؤاد تعلقا وتلاه في جنح الدجى متدبرا والدمع من بين الجفون ترقرقا هذه صفات الحافظين كتابه حقا فكن بصفاتهم متخلقا.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا وحبيبنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وعملا متقبلا يا رب. We talked last time by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's help about asbab al-nuzul, which means the occasions of revelation of some ayat of the Quran. And we said the ayat of the Quran are two types. The first type are ayat that were revealed without a specific occasion. And this applies to most of the ayat about the previous nations, about the previous peoples, the stories of the prophets, and these things. And the other type of the ayat, or the other section, is the ayat that are related to the ahkam, to the sharia rulings, to halal and haram. Most also to akhlaq, to the morals, to the characters. And most of these ayat, they have occasions for revealing them. And we said there is a great wisdom behind this. This is out of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy to the believers. When they have a problem, when they have a question, when they have an issue or a dispute, then those ayat will come to answer their questions, to resolve their problem, to bring a solution to their disputes, so they will realize how important the ayat are, how important the Quran is, and that will help them to act upon these ayat. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's great wisdom. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already knows what will happen, and the ayat, as Muslims believe, the Quran is the eternal words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these words are eternal, they are known. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already recorded them in the sacred tablet, in Al-Lawh al-Mahfuz. So Allah did not reveal those ayat except according or after those occasions took place that helped the believers to attach to the Qur'an, to find their life in the Qur'an, to find the solutions of their problem in the Qur'an. And one of the brothers requested that I mention some more examples, and particularly about the ayat of fighting. He said, many ayat, you cannot understand the ayah unless you know the occasion of revealing that ayah. What is the condition in which that ayah was revealed to our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? We mentioned some examples, and I will mention some more examples inshallah in this short time. For example, the Jews came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was, as Imam Bukhari narrated, that Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he said, I was with Anas, or I was with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, walking in Al-Madinah. So some Jews came and asked him. They asked him about the soul, Ar-Ruh. And the Prophet ﷺ, as we mentioned earlier, when he receives a question that he doesn't know the answer, that he has no ayat about it, he will be silent ﷺ. And he will wait for the wahi, for the revelation to come. So he was silent for a moment ﷺ, then the revelation came to him. قُلْ يَرْرُوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي وَمَا أُوْتِيتُم مِّنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. Surah Isra, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْرُوحِ. Surah Isra, ayah 85, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْرُوحِ. They ask you about the soul. قُلْ يَرْرُوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي. Say, the soul is something out of the command of my Lord. It is specific. It is only, it is exclusively known to Allah. وَمَا أُوْتِيْتُم مِّنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. All the knowledge that you have been given is only few, is only a little amount of knowledge. This is all what you have been given, a little amount of knowledge. So this is an example. Another very important example is the ayat about the khamr, about forbidding the wine. We know that forbidding the wine went through three stages. First, the first ayat that was revealed or that were revealed to the Prophet ﷺ, Surah Al-Baqarah, ayat 219. يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْخَمْرِ وَالْمَيْسِرِ قُلْ فِيهِمَا إِثْمٌ كَبِيرٌ وَمَنَافِعُ لِلنَّاسِ وَإِثْمُهُمَا أَكْبَرُ مِنْ نَفْعِهِمَا. They ask you about wine and about gambling. Say, فِيهِمَا إِثْمٌ كَبِيرٌ وَمَنَافِعُ لِلنَّاسِ. They have in them big sin, a lot of sin, and some benefits for people. They have sin and they have some benefit for people, or they have wrong things, bad things, and they have some benefits. So if someone comes now and reads this ayah, by itself, he will say, well, Allah is not saying khamr is haram. Allah is saying they have some benefits and they have some harm. So maybe it's makruh, it's not haram, it's not forbidden, maybe it is disliked. But we say, this was the first stage, as Imam Ahmad narrated radiallahu anhu, that Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu said, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to Al-Madina, people, even some Muslims, they used to drink wine and to play with gambling and maysir and these things. So Allah revealed those ayat or this ayat. Then people said, well, it is not forbidden. Allah said they have some harm, they have big harm, and they have some benefits in them. SubhanAllah. Then the next stage came. The next stage came where the ayat revealed, or where someone was leading the prayer and he changed the ayat in a very bad meaning. So the ayat came, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَقْرَبُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَأَنْتُمْ سُكَارَى حَتَّى تَعْلَمُوا مَا تَقُولُونَ. Do not come to prayer, do not pray while you are drunk, so that you know what you are saying. So that was the second level. So now they realized, we cannot, now they started thinking, Allah is saying they have a lot of harm. So this means Allah doesn't like it. So some of them quit from the first stage. In the second stage, don't come to prayer. And you know, you have Fajr, then you have Dhuhr, you have Asr, you have the times of Salah, they are close. So many of them, they would just drink Khamr after Isha. That would be the only time for them, or maybe after Fajr. So see the great divine wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how His mercy to His creatures. He doesn't want to torture us, subhanAllah, subhanAllah. He doesn't want to torture us. He could have just said, it is haram and that's it. And they have to follow. What can we do? What can we do? We are just slaves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah is the most merciful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as He said, وَاللَّهُ يُرِيدُ أَن يَتُوبَ عَلَيْكُمْ. Allah wants to forgive you. Allah doesn't want to make it difficult for you. Allah wants ease for you. مَا جَعْلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجٍ. Allah doesn't want to make difficulty for you. Subhanallah. See how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the heavens and the earth, is dealing with Muslims, and how now some Muslims dealing with some other Muslims. They want them to be, just in one day, to be like the Sahaba. In one day they want them to pray and fast and do everything in one day. Subhanallah. We need to learn from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala how to act, how to invite people and how to apply these rulings. Then few people remained until the last stage when the ayat came, إِنَّمَا الْخَمْرُ وَالْمَيْسِرُ وَالْأَنْصَابُ وَالْأَزْلَامُ رِجْسٌ مِّنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. The khamr and the maysir, these are from the shaytan, these are sins, these are impure, so avoid it. Then إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ الشَّيْطَانُ أَنْ يُوقِعَ بَيْنَكُمُ الْعَدَاوَةَ وَالْبَغْضَاءَ فِي الْخَمْرِ وَالْمَيْسِرِ وَيَصُدَّكُمْ عَنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَعَنِ الصَّلَاةِ فَهَلْ أَنْتُمْ مُنْتَهُونَ. Surely the shaytan wants to make disputes and to make hatred among you and to push you away from salah and from the dhikr of Allah. So will you stop? So they said, إِنْتَهَيْنَا رَبَّنَا انْتَهَيْنَا. We have stopped. And they broke the jars and the pots of wine right away after that ayah. So because they were prepared. Subhanallah, this is the great wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you cannot take an ayah and understand it by yourself. No, you have to refer to the scholars and see, because many of these ayahs, they have occasions of revelation. They have conditions. You have to understand it within its condition. And the last example, some ayahs about fighting. And this is unfortunately very much spread among some Muslims, even among some scholars. Even among some scholars, they say, or they take some of those ayat and they apply them in all situations. They say, Allah says, فَقْتُلُوا الْمُشْرِكِينَ حَيْثُ وَجَدْتُمُوا. Kill the pagans or the polytheists wherever you find them. فَقْتُلُوهُمْ حَيْثُ ثَقِفْتُمُوهُمْ. Kill them wherever you find them. فَإِذَا انْسَلَخَ الْأَشْهُرُ الْحُرُمُ فَقْتُلُوا الْمُشْرِكِينَ. They quote some of these ayat and they don't realize that they were in specific conditions and they had specific reasons. And they forget about tens of ayat that are clarifying or that clarify these ayat. These ayat about killing the pagans or the polytheists, they are about those who broke the treaties with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Allah mentions in those ayat, in the same surah, in Surah Al-Tawbah and in Surah Al-Baqarah, He mentions that those are the ones who started taking you out of your homes. They broke the treaties and the promises with you. So they are the ones who started. And those who did not do harm to you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَاتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ وَلَا تَعْتَدُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُعْتَدِينَ. Fight for the sake of Allah those who fight you. And do not transgress. Very clear ayah. The other ayah I read, لَا إِكْرَاهَ فِي الدِّينِ. There should be no compulsion in religion. قَدْ تَبَيَّنَ الرُّشْدُ مِنَ الْغَيْبِ. Because if you force people, you tell people you will either be killed or you embrace Islam. Well, they will accept Islam apparently, but they will conceal hypocrisy. And they will have hatred towards Islam. And they will plan and do their best to destroy Islam because they are not convinced. Islam and religion and faith is about conviction, it's not about compulsion. So another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I will finish with this ayah. The main ayah about our relation with non-Muslims in general, all non-Muslims. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Mumtahina revealed a clear ayah about our relation with non-Muslims, all non-Muslims. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لا ينهاكم الله عن الذين لم يقاتلوكم في الدين ولم يخرجوكم من دياركم أن تبروهم وتقسطوا إليهم إن الله يحب المقسطين. Allah does not forbid you to deal kindly and justly with those who did not fight you because of your religion, and those who did not expel you out of your houses. Surely Allah loves those who are just. Clear-cut ayah. This type of ayah is not abrogated, does not change. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you, He does not forbid you to deal kindly and justly with those who did not fight you because of your religion, nor did they expel you out of your house, of your home. Surely Allah loves those who are just. Is not this ayah clear? Anyone who does not fight you, does not expel you out of your house, Allah does not forbid you to deal kindly and justly with them. SubhanAllah. How can we forget this ayah or ignore this ayah and take those ayat out of their context and apply it in a wrong way and go and make an explosion here and kill these people here and kill these tourists here and there and these journalists there and those aid workers there? How come? This is unfortunately how some Muslims, they deviated from these basic concepts in our religion because they understood these ayat by themselves, and maybe some of them they have their agendas, and maybe some of them they have the international intelligence agencies, they've infiltrated them. Doesn't matter, there are some Muslims, this is what they believe. We know them, we deal with them, we argue with them, we try to convince them, they are there. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you, and some of the scholars, he gave a very, very beautiful point about this ayah. He said, why Allah said, He does not forbid you to deal justly and kindly, to deal kindly and justly with them. He said, because the human nature is that when someone doesn't fight you and doesn't do harm to you, the human nature says that you deal kindly with them, you deal justly with them. So Allah, as if Allah is telling you, He doesn't forbid you to deal according to your nature with them. Your nature tells you that you don't wrong someone, you don't fight someone, you don't force someone who did not fight you, who did not do harm to you, so deal justly and kindly with them. And He said kindly and justly, not only with justice, no, with even kindness. This is how we apply the Quran. This is how we understand the ayat of the Quran in the light of the other ayat. We don't take an ayah out of its context. We don't take an ayah without understanding the occasion of revealing this ayah. This is how our religion is. The religion of peace, the religion of mercy, not the religion of compulsion at all. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those who listen to the speech and follow its best. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us and guide all Muslims and all people. صلي اللهم على سيدنا محمد وآله وصحبه والحمد لله رب العالمين.
يا حافظ القرآن رتل آيه فالكل أنصت للتلاوة مطرقا. يا حافظ القرآن لست بحافظ حتى تكون لما حفظت مطبقا. ماذا يفيدك أن تسمى حافظا وكتاب ربك في الفؤاد تمزقا.
يا أمتي القرآن حبا.
بذواتنا فتمسكي بعراه كي لا نغرق والتجمع حول الكتاب شتاتنا حتى نزيل تناحرا وتفرقا ولتجعلي محكما في أمرنا وثقي بوعد الله أن يتحققا يا أمتي القرآن حبل نجاتنا فتمسكي بعراه كي